Thank you. Good morning again. And in particular, thank you for actually being here. You know, when I got this mail that on Saturday there would be the party, I thought, wow, amazing. So I need to be responsible on Saturday, and I'm going to be alone on Sunday morning. Thank you for being here. I want to talk about serverless Python, about serverless computing on the example of AWS Lambda. And AWS Lambda here is really just a placeholder for all those serverless computing technologies out there. The numbers are a tiny bit different, the details are different, the principle is the same. I want to talk about what that is, the serverless computing stuff, and what you need it, when you need it, when you should start thinking about it and use it. Okay. What about me? I'm Murat. I'm serving as CTO at EngageSpark, and I live in Cebu City. This is not Cebu City, unfortunately, but it's one of those beautiful places nearby. If you ever feel like beach or diving or so, drop by, say hello, don't be a stranger, shoot me a mail, and I'll connect you with some dive sites and point you in the right direction about you for a beer. Cool. What does EngageSpark do? EngageSpark is about interacting with people, people that don't have internet, that just have a phone, a dumb phone, a Nokia from the 90s, and you can NGOs and corporations and companies and you can interact with people just with SMS and voice. This is the idea, so you can do spread out information, you can gather information, whatever you can do with a phone, phone calls and SMS, that's what we do. And this is very important because if you look very closely, it just says nothing about monitoring free disk space. Stuff like that. There is nothing about figuring out provisioning new servers. EngageSpark's mission is not about patching a kernel that has a security flaw. All this stuff, it's very exciting. I love personally troubleshooting. It's intellectually very stimulating, but it's not our mission, and I'm quite sure that for most people in this room, it's not your business either to figure out server maintenance. It's writing code. No, that's what we want to do. We want to write code. We want to bring our business forward. We want to make our customers happy. Usually that has to do with Python because in the end this is PyCon. So this is what we should be focusing on. Yeah, this is in the sense the promise of serverless computing, that you focus on Python code, on beautiful Python code, on PEP 8 compliant Python code, on stuff that we actually love doing and bring our business forward, making this beautiful planet a bit better, this kind of stuff, and not provisioning something. Okay. So what do we need to talk about? I just noticed that the blue is, can you read that? For the most part, I hope. What we need to talk about is first, what is serverless. Yeah? We have, as an industry, this amazing habit, this knack for finding words that are confusing one half of the population and infuriating the other because they're just sort of vague, not really meaning anything, nobody knows what exactly they mean. Serverless is no different. Yeah, cloud, you probably have struggled with for, at least many people have struggled for a decade what that means. And then came dust computing, fantastic word, it made my morning when I first heard that. And now we have serverless, so we need to talk about this one. And then some do's and don'ts. There are some issues that you need to know about serverless that decide in the end if you can use it or not. And we need to talk about this. I'm going to have a small demo, depending on time. And yeah, some considerations around design. Let's see. Cool. Let's get started. If you read about Lambda online, then you will find people that will tell you Lambda is it. Yeah? It's replacing all your servers in the next couple of months. It will replace your laptop. It will replace your house, your cat, your girlfriend, and your coffee machine. Yeah, Lambda, this is the end of all of it. And this is, of course, not true. Yeah, that's absurd. I personally like my coffee, so I do need a coffee machine. So the real question becomes, for what tool is Lambda the right job? Yeah, when do we actually need this kind of thing? When does it solve our problem? If you want to get a nail into a wall, you can pick one of those wrenches, but you really should be using a hammer. If you need one of those wrenches, you need to pick the right size, no? Otherwise, you're just having a very hard time. And it's the same with Lambda. There are some things that it's exceptionally good at, and we need to figure out which one. This is engineering in the end. You know, you need to figure out what problem you're actually having, then you figure out the right solution for it, and consider the trade-offs, this kind of stuff. Okay, so Lambda in the end is one step in a journey that we are on as an industry. We came from bare metal servers, the good old days. Some of you probably don't remember those physical things that are under somebody's desk or so. You pick a CPU, you match it with a motherboard, you put it in somewhere, and then you host it somewhere in some data center, and then you run your Python code, you're very happy, and then the hard disk dies. And you're just thinking, come on, I want to run my Python code here. So, and then you think, okay, scrap this, we're going to use a VM, no? This is the solution, we are using VMs now, we are cool. So, and then suddenly somebody is telling you about a CVE, about some kernel security, and you're trying to figure out the next week how to patch your kernel without restarting the server, and you can't, and then you throw away the VM and you use Docker. Yeah, so it's so much better. You don't need to take care of the kernel. Somebody's doing it for you, and it turns out then, ooh, you still have this Docker file with 20 lines of code that installs some packages that get outdated that you need to maintain, and you're going to get angry again because you want to write Python code. So then you're at serverless. Welcome serverless. Yeah, this is the promise that you focus on your code and not on all this other stuff. You focus on writing Python code, on your Python dependencies, and you upload this, you zip it, actually, and you upload it into the cloud. Something or someone is running your Python code, and you don't bother about the rest. This is the idea. Yeah? And then it turns out that you actually don't have much there where your Python code is running. It's just a container somewhere, some server that you can't control, that you don't know much about and shouldn't know much about. And that means that you can't be running a local Redis or a local memcache or anything. Yeah? You need to connect to something. So Lambda and serverless is a lot about APIs and services. If you want to store a file, you're not going to store it on the local disk. There basically, for the large part, is no local disk. So you store it on S3 or whatever service that you want to use. If you want a database, not on your server, you need to connect to it. So you run your Python code, and it's connecting to stuff on somewhere on the net. Okay? That's very important, so Lambda's a lot about connecting. The good news is that you don't maintain this environment. This container or server that it's running in, you're not maintaining it, but you also don't control it. That means that you get some environment, and you better be happy with it, or you move on to something else. Yeah, for example, AWS provides you Python 3.6. And now you're so excited, and you want to use Python 3.8 alpha version, yeah? And then it turns out you can't. With Lambda, you cannot. You have a drop-down, and you pick Python 3.6 or 2.7, and that's where your Python code runs, and you better like it. No, and this goes the other way, too, if you want Python 2.4 because you're very old school and you go with this museum-style software, then that's great, but you can't use Lambda. Yeah? So you don't maintain it, but you also don't control it. It goes both ways. Also, if you want to be near the hardware, Lambda is also not the right abstraction level. This is not the right tool for you. Okay. How do you program this stuff? When does your code run? Turns out your code runs only when needed. Yeah? It's like a superhero. Yeah? A superhero does the dishes, does the day job, and then at some point it turns out, oh my goodness, Godzilla is running by. Yeah? And then the superhero tears off the shirt and then runs there, defeats Godzilla, and goes back to washing dishes. No? And this is exactly like your Lambda. Your Lambda does nothing, exactly nothing for the most part, and then suddenly something happens. Yeah? A mail arrives, and your Lambda processes the mail and stores it in a database. That's maybe not the most heroic thing a Lambda can do, but it illustrates the point that your Lambda is only doing something when something important is happening, yeah, on an event. An HTTP request arrives. A mail arrives. Your Lambda is running, processing it. Every 5 minutes you want your Lambda to run, great. You can configure it, and it will do that. Okay, so this is very event-driven, very asynchronous. If your application follows this kind of model, that is awesome, like a JSON API. there is almost no reason that you would a simple JSON API that you would be deploying that with Kubernetes or whatever, you're going to use serverless, because you are not in the business of maintaining servers. Something you also don't want to do is wait around for events to happen. Yeah? You don't want to be polling a queue or something. You want to configure the system that it calls you, your code, when something is in the queue. Why is that important? Because you pay for usage. Yeah, you pay for every 100 milliseconds that your code is running. Every time it's starting, you pay. And every time that you, every 100 milliseconds, it's you're paying. But there are some numbers there for comparison. You also pay for memory, of course. Yeah, the more memory you use, the more you pay, kind of fair. 1 million requests come in, HTTP requests, mails, whatever it is. 1 million times your code is starting, and it costs you 20 cents. Let's say you have 1 hour after midnight, ghost hour, as we call it in Germany, and there's lots of spam mails coming in that you want to process for whatever reason. Yeah? Then you can either get an EC2 instance that is exactly doing nothing for the most part of the day, or a droplet or whatever it is, or you have a Lambda there that just exactly processes those 10,000 mails that come in after midnight, and that's it. Yeah, you're paying for that, for nothing more. So billing-wise, that is very nice. One thing to not forget, and this is a gotcha, you still have all those curves that you connect to, you need to pay for those. No? Sometimes people forget that they think, oh, it's so cheap, it's just computing, oh, it almost costs nothing. And then suddenly it turns out that for logging you pay more than for actually computing. And hallelujah, then your bill doubles or triples. And so the usual stuff with all these cloud things is that you need to figure out billing. You need to look at the details. It's not fun, but it's maybe it's worth the time to look at those details up front and then figure out that you're in the end much cheaper off than otherwise with a permanent server that you need to maintain. Okay, so here the idea is measure stuff. Yeah? Don't just assume something, don't believe me. Well, for sure don't believe me. Yeah? Test everything, measure everything, figure out the details. Be fast, be lean, you're paying for every 100 milliseconds. Limits. You're not in control of this environment, and they're showing you. Yeah? They show you exactly that. In AWS case, after 5 minutes, your process dies. If you want to do something more with an HTTP request or a mail or whatever it is that you're doing, then you need to split this up. After 5 minutes, your process is dead. Okay? Then you need to choose memory. For example, 128 megabytes is the default. You can go up to 3 gigabytes in Amazon, Microsoft, you have only 1.5, but that should be fine for most things, right? So the problem here is that if you're choosing for your code, that it, let's say 500 megabyte, then you're going to pay for 500 megabyte every time. If most of the time you just need 30 megabytes, but there might be a mail with a very big cat picture, then you're going to pay for 500 megabyte every single time. So you need to, again, measure this stuff and optimize in the end for your bill. No? And you don't have permanent disk space. As I mentioned, you need to use S3 or something like that. There is a temporary disk space that sometimes is there and sometimes might be there and cannot be there. You can't rely on anything. Basically, it's don't trust anybody. So just store stuff in S3 or somewhere permanent if you need it. This also means that you can't use Lambda for something that can't be terminated. Yeah, if you are running something that where you're not sure how long it's going to take and that can't be dying in the middle, after 5 minutes it's gone. So you don't run that on Lambda. Okay. One of the exciting things about Lambda and this whole billing idea is that we have some people that are older than me, which makes me feel good. Older programmers sometimes used to tell me about the time of punch cards, no? And they would be telling that back in the days when you brought your punch cards to a processor, a data center, something, then they would run it and it would be super expensive. So what they would be doing is spending the evenings optimizing those punch cards for less code in the end, because it is so damn expensive to run. Yeah? So you're better off spending your time optimizing this code than actually just running whatever computation is cheap, no? And the cool thing with Lambda is that you're being rewarded for being a good programmer in the end for writing efficient code, and it's immediately visible. Yeah, if your code takes 3 seconds to run, then you're paying 3 times as much as if it just takes 1 second to run. Yeah, so this is actually a very cool thing from an efficiency standpoint, that your code, your it's very visible if it's fast or not. You're gonna pay for it. Okay, that is a terrible user experience right here. This is a car in winter. The idea is that if your code is slow in starting, like a car in winter, you have a problem. Because every time this mail arrives and your Lambda, your Python code, your Lambda is running, it's going to be starting up and it's going to be terribly slow. Yeah, this is the cold start problem Lambda. You can Google that. So you have a bunch of solutions here. Every time your code is starting, for example, yeah, you start Django and you're the superhero guy, so time for you moves slower than for other people. And you can see those 100 milliseconds ticking off and your bill increasing all the time for just one request. Okay? So that's not going to work. You're going to pay a lot and it's just going to be slow. So you need to figure out something. Either you're going to throw away the whole overhead and do just fast code that just returns very quickly, low latency. If you can't do that, then you need to take advantage of some implementation detail in Amazon Lambda and in others. The idea is that Lambda 2 uses locality of time, is usually the term. That means that they expect when one mail arrives that you're interested in and that you need to process, there's likely to be another mail. So they keep this process around where your code is running. And if another mail is arriving soon or another event is happening that triggers your code, it's going to be fast. Like, let's say 5 minutes is a good point in time. For that long, they wait if something is happening, and then your code is going to be fast. So even if you have a slow startup, you can still, within 5 minutes, if you're being reused, it's going to be fast again. Okay? The problem is, what if nothing happens in 5 minutes? Yeah, then that environment is being cleaned up, and your code will be starting fresh again. It's going to be slow. Sucks. Okay, what do we do? Well, we can hack this, no? We can write a cron job that just triggers this code every 5 minutes, and then it's going to be fresh all the time. And that's exactly what you can do. You configure your Lambda to run every 5 minutes. In addition to whatever mail or HTTP request it's supposed to be processing, that works. Or you just bundle all your code in a way that it just runs all the time. And then also, problem solved. There is some more details there, as with everything. Every 4 hours, this is going to be cleaned up anyway, so you're better off by just being fast in the first place, no? But if you can't, then this is a way to do it by just keeping Lambdas warm, as the terminology there goes. Yeah. So it turns out there's a lot to be done here, no? It's not just writing code, unfortunately. There's also a lot of configuration to be done. So you need to figure out, when is your code running? What are you connecting it to? Are you connecting it to HTTP? If yes, then what are the routes, the URLs? Yeah? How do you make your code run? That is something annoying. So IAM, if ever, who here has used an AWS IAM user interface? Anybody here? Yeah? This is, if anybody of you needs a hug afterwards or so, no, this is the stuff that makes grown-ups cry. This business there with resource IDs and rights and access management, this is terrible. So this you need to take care of. And then keeping Lambdas warm, keeping code warm. And so there's a lot to be done there. And as it turns out, people don't want to do that. As you might know, the UI is really not that great. So people have automated this stuff. No? There are some frameworks there that you need to look at. So if you think that your application model supports this, that you have something to react to that is quite fast, that that means that you don't have to maintain servers, if all this stuff applies, then you might want to look at a framework that helps you with all this stuff. So for example, Serverless is a framework, from earlier framework, that supports a whole bunch of languages. So for example, the other ones that are used in AWS, you can use Go, you can use Java, JavaScript. Those are supported, that's nice. We will look at Chalice in a second. Enables you to just deploy an HTTP API very quickly. Yeah, within a few seconds, I hope we can still do that. And yeah, then there is Amazon at some point also figured out that this is not working, so they introduced SAM, and there is Zappa for Django. Yeah, I mean, initially people tried to use Django on Lambda, very enthusiastic, and then it turned out, oh my goodness, it's slow. So, and then Zappa was created to handle, to make this faster and make it work. All right, what I want to do now is very quickly show you some code, and that's it. Okay, what I've done so far is I've set up a virtual environment. I installed Chalice. We're not going to do that, so I'm just skipping ahead a bit. And I'm going to copy a lot of stuff because I've seen enough demos where I can't type, and that's a terrible idea. So we're going to just start a new project. Okay. Then we're just going to go there and quickly look at what we got. What is here? There is a requirements.txt, there's nothing, okay? What else is here? An app.py. So we're going to look at app.py, see what we got. We have... Let me fix that for you. See that we're still there. The demos can fail or if you fix it. Amazing. Ah, come on. I'm going to cheat. So here is my emails, JetWorks, and here. Okay, this is stuff that I copied. What we have here, it's in the end, there is a tiny, it's a route, it's a Flask app. It looks exactly like a Flask app, and it just prints hello world. I'm just going to change that here. Oh, that's why I don't type. Okay, we have here this Chalice app, some comments, and we're just going to... Let's say do hello world here, replace it with hello Python. Okay, we're going to do Chalice deploy. Already configured somewhere my AWS API keys. Okay, now it's doing all the crazy stuff. Yeah? Now it's creating a role there with access rights. It's creating an API gateway, something, something. And all very, very stuff that you don't want to do. Yeah. So what we have is a very, very tiny API, and at some point, if it ever works, we have this URL here. Okay. So this is what Chalice gives you. This tiny, the string, this URL, and if we curl that, then we get here at some point, hello Python. And this is now an extremely scalable API. You can call this many, many times. It will be free. And yeah, basically free for a long while because there is the free tier. So this is pretty cool already. So what I want to do now is I just want to replace this with some bit more code, and we'll look at that here. So first we're going to do Chalice, yeah, same thing. We have an app, and then we have a root. And then what we do here is we look at the query parameters, we take the message, okay? So we have a query parameter there. We are going to get the PyCon schedule, okay? So schedule from the web page, and we're going to print something back, and that will be we count in the response, so in the schedule, the keyword, okay? That's what our tiny, not so useful API is going to do. But it's going to be great anyway. Okay, how do we do that? Copy this stuff. Find the PyCon app.py. Okay, now we have this code here. We throw away the rest. And we're going to deploy again. There I forgot stuff, that's why I usually have all this stuff written out. What we need is requests, yeah? To make a true request, we need a request library. Nothing magical there. Okay, so what I can do now is we have the same URL, we append PyCon and message, I don't know, equals, we had a robot top, right? So that appeared 4 times, that is cool. My name should appear 2, I hope, otherwise I'm wrong. Okay, I appear 1 time, excellent. So this is something that, I now created a tiny API that does something. You can imagine it can do much more. But all I had to worry about in the end is requirements.txt, that is Python, and some Python code. Yeah, and this is the idea that you can build something extremely scalable with just that. If we have time, I don't think we have time, so I'm just going to slip to the last time. Okay, so why would you want to use Lambda? I think by default nowadays you should consider it and have reasons not to use it, basically, yeah? Because you're not in the business of maintaining servers. And what is great about it can be very, very cheap, very cost effective. Can be, it doesn't have to be. Yeah, you need to check. You need to check the details. It's extremely scalable because they do that for you. 1,000 in parallel is the limit that they impose, but you can extend that too. That's not easy to do with a tiny server that you get yourself, and you focus on writing code. So for new codes, for new projects, you should consider it. And gotchas are, in the end, configuration. You need to configure all this stuff. You need to look at billing, and you have those limits. You can't get around those. So you need, okay? And in the end, small print. There's a lot of vendor small print. Every vendor is slightly bit different. You need to figure out when Lambda makes sense for you. But if it does, then you should use that. And maybe do I still have 1 minute or?
Yeah, 1 or 2 quick questions or 1 minute.
Okay. The one thing that I quickly then will mention, because you always can catch me in the hallway for question, is Lambda is about connecting, and the cloud is getting more about connecting services and stuff that is there. Okay, so that means that the idea of open source, when knowledge is in the code, gets diminished. Knowledge is now a lot in APIs and in data. Yeah, so this is something that I see that I would really like in this Lambda context to for us to figure out as a community how we can get actually open Lambdas, how we can get to a point where we can use existing services in an open way, no? Because that goes more and more away, and the power of our code is then more like just a bit of connecting services that exist, and not so much about actually creating something new in that sense. Thank you.